I think it's on.
Yeah.
Well, it's a pleasure to welcome today's speaker, Professor Edgar Costa from MIT, and he will speak about effective obstruction to lifting algebraic classes from positive characteristic. Edgar?
Thank you for the introduction, Yuri. First of all, thank you for the invitation to speak here. Over my years at the New York City, I really enjoyed the seminars. It was really a key moment to learn about number theory. So first thing, my slides are available. I put the link again in the chat. You can try to follow. I bundle the slides like the pre-talk and the talk. So you just need to skip many slides to get to where we are now. So let me get started. So I'm going to start with very simple. I'll start with an elliptic curve. And my first question is, given an elliptic curve with A, B, and Z, can you describe in a simple way as a function of P the number of points of this elliptic curve modulo P? Now, as a function, it's already a function. There's nothing else that I can do about it. But the question is simple. Like in a way that you could like teach an undergrad to evaluate that function. And S is a bit hard. Like for certain cases we have such a, for certain families of elliptic curves we have such a function, but in general we don't. For example, in certain cases we can describe it as in terms of Jacobi symbols, but not for every elliptic curve. A reverse question is given the number of points of this elliptic curve for many primes, sorry, of the relation for many primes, can you say something about this elliptic curve? So can you reverse engineer? Can we do some properties just purely from the point counts? And the answer is not obvious a priori, unless you already know that, unless you already know my talk and you, or at least you know what's involved there. But this basically leads us to like, let's try to study statistical properties of the point counts of this elliptic curve. Now, if you have thought about this problem before, the first thing you know that is when I say statistically, you know that counting points of the elliptic curve is not the right thing. And that's the reason because of Asset's bound. Asset tells you that if you really think about the elliptic curve as a double cover of P1, then you know that the average number of points is gonna be P plus one. Think about it like for each point on the on P1, you have a half probability of having no points above it because you don't cannot solve the square root, or you have two solutions. So on average, you really expect P plus one. And then the interesting thing, at least the moment when Asset proved it, is that when you take the difference, we call this AP, this difference is bounded between minus two square root of P and two square, minus two square root of P and two square root of P. Obviously, if you know what's going on behind the scenes, or we have easier proofs nowadays, is that this AP is nothing else than the trace of Frobenius. And my number of points of my elliptic curve is evaluating my Frobenius polynomial, L, at one. So if I really want to study statistical properties of the number of points, I should really study statistical properties AP, but then I need to be careful. I need to study them normalized, right? Otherwise, it doesn't make sense. If I start to do histograms of AP and allow P go to infinity in this interval, then my interval is getting larger and larger and larger. So yeah, there will be some concentration at zero, but statistically, you'll have no value. So if we normalize, now this AP over square root of P will be between now minus two and two. How does this behave as P goes to infinity? So if you know, since you know elliptic curves, you know that there are two types of elliptic curves. And I'm not going to show you the histograms because I can show you the picture, the final picture as when you let the limit get infinity, when you get the limit to infinity. So you have the generic case, the non-CM case, you'll get a nice circular shape. And then you have the CM case, like CM by some square root of minus D. Then you get a totally different shape. And the fact that this you get this shape is known as Saturday conjecture, which is a theorem for elliptic over Q. And I should just be clear here, this dash here is not a is a artifact because of Dirac delta, so it should go all the way to infinity. But that's basically what happens at for primes ramified or inert in Q squared of minus z. For those primes, you get AP equals zero all the time. So you get totally different distributions. So in some way, with enough primes, you'll expect like I can distinguish between two cases. So my question for you guys is like, how are you going to go about distinguishing between two types? Now, there are plenty of specialists in the audience, so I'm sure you're going to come up with your own way. But now I really want to go back to the Stone Age. I don't want to be using J-invariants. I don't use about like some advanced like Eladic image theorem. I want to just use APs. So one option is, for example, we have this like Dirac delta. We can just like ask ourselves, for how many primes I'm hitting AP equals zero. That already will give you some good guess. But I'm going to propose something a bit different. And I'm going to propose just really look at n-dimensional algebra over the finite field and then see how that relates with n-dimensional algebra over Q bar. So FP bar, Q bar. That's the two things I want to be playing. So first thing you should make precise that my n-dimensional algebra over Q bar is going to embed in my n-dimensional algebra of FP bar. And more importantly, if I look at the field generated by Frobenius, that's inside of my n-dimensional algebra of FP bar. Indeed, it is a standard. So more importantly, after that, is that if I have AP not zero, modulo P, then this thing in the middle is just a quadratic field, nothing else. If AP equals zero, then it's super singular, and then you know, gonna get a quaternary algebra when life gets more complicated. But there are plenty of APs that are not zero. So let's just focus on those. So okay, this is what I was saying before. Like if AP equals zero, then I really get this like strict inequality, and life gets a bit harder. But the key part is that when AP is not zero, so basically when I have this quadratic field, I can try to intersect my FP bar in a Hermitian algebras because I have two quadratic fields. So I know how to intersect two quadratic fields. And in this case, if I'm in the case non-CM, I'll get Q with probability one because these will be random quadratic fields. In the case I have CM, I'll be obtaining all the time the same quadratic field. So in this way, this helps you to figure out between the two cases. Now, in the case I ever observe two primes that gives me this, I know I'm in this case. I know I'm in the generic case. But if I keep observing this over and over, if I keep observing some quadratic field, I have no proof, or this does not give you proof that you are in this case, in the CM case. You need to do a bit extra work. Obviously, there are some effective versions of this, where you say, given the conductor, these are large, you need to consider P and so on. But I'm avoiding this in this talk. Obviously, you can also just ask another effective version of the Sato Tate and like ask you like how fast you're going to converge to these two distributions. And also effective version of that of the Sato Tate conjecture that tell you exactly how fast you're going to converge to either distribution. So by using that, you can also precisely, provably, distinguish between the two types by only looking at APs. The sad thing about those two statements is that despite they being effective, they're not practical. So I'm just going to try to keep things practical for this talk. So I'm going to skip those arguments and just stick to reality, which is like, I don't want to use infinitely many APs, I just use a couple of them. So let me just give an example, which is, I start with the sometimes what's known the first elliptic curve. So I pick an elliptic curve of conductor 11, the smallest possible conductor, and just take the first two primes. I take two and I take three. So in this case, over f2 bar, I get q squared of minus 11, minus 1. And over f3 bar, I get q squared of minus 11. The unique field that's inside of those two fields is q. So I'm done. I've proved that this has no complex multiplication. And again, in your mind, you might be screaming at me right now, use the invariant, use other techniques. But the key part is that I'm not relying on any classification yet. Like, yes, in this case, I know that I'm going to get all quadratic fields. But I didn't so far use the fact that there's only two types of elliptic curves. Like, I could have done this for any other Abelian variety. And I'll show you how to do that later. Now, the sad thing is that, as I pointed out that before, that if I have complex multiplication, I'm a bit stuck. I, for example, these examples, like the first example or the smallest example with complex multiplication. By the way, these are the labels of the elliptic curves on the LMFDB database. And in this case, if you can go for all the primes, but we know exactly what happens, that for p congruent to 2 mod 3, I'm going to get ap equals 0. And did I always get quaternary algebra as expected? And for p equals 1 mod 3, I always get q squared of minus 3. So now I put this quickly arrow because I have some evidence, and it depends on how many primes you want to test. I have strong evidence that I indeed have complex multiplication by q squared of minus 3, but I don't have a proof. But for me, that's okay at the moment. I'll tell you later on how to get the proof if you want. But you should just think about this, that I'm giving you a simple primality testing. Like, if I was trying to test numbers of prime, there are provable methods how to test the numbers of prime, but the most fast methods are probabilistic. They never give you a theorem, just give you probability. What's the probability of that that the number is a prime? So here's the same thing. More primes you give, more primes you're going to observe this trend, and more convinced you're going to be about q that it has CM by q squared of minus 3. Okay, any questions so far? I should also say that you can just interrupt me anytime. I'm happy to stop and discuss things more in more detail. Okay, I'll move along. I also speak quite fast, and I realize I'm speaking faster than I planned, so I will try to remind myself to slow down. Now let's go to the real meat of the problem. Let's go to genus of curves, or Abelian surface if you want. So now there are not two types. Now we know how to classify Abelian surface. There are six types, or at least I classify them into six types. You can classify them in many other types, but now life is not so easy. Now it's not just like distinguishing between two cases, it's distinguishing between various cases. So the question is still the same. By looking at my Abelian variety model P or Abelian surface, do I know how to distinguish between all these cases? Now, what I really want, I don't want to be relying on this table, but I'm going to use this table to lead us to the theory or the theorem that I want to present to you guys, that we can indeed distinguish between these types by just using Frobenius polynomials. So let's learn about inomorphism algebras over finite fields of Abelian varieties. So the first thing is that my Frobenius polynomial, my determinant of Frobenius acting on H1, uniquely determines the isogeny class. Not only that, also tells us the inomorphism algebra up to isomorphism. It doesn't tell generators, but it tells us what are the Brouwer invariants. So we would know it on the nose what it is. And the way you want to think about this, we should be thinking about this in terms of algebraic cycles. And indeed, the way you prove this indeed was by Tate. And the idea is that we should think about our inomorphisms as divisorial correspondence in A cross A, I'm sorry, A comma A. So basically, I mean by that is that each inomorphism, you can have a graph in A cross A that's not trivial. So what I mean by a graph that's not trivial is basically it does not project down one coordinate or the other one. And in that case, I can just say basically the inomorphism of A is isomorphic to the divisorial correspondence of A cross A. And the key part here is that now you can think about inomorphisms as algebraic cycles in A cross A. And this sits in a nice homology of A1 tensor A1. So now the Tate conjectures, which was proven by Tate, tells that indeed I can read what's the rank of my inference algebra, basically by just looking at the dimension of this kernel. But the dimension of this kernel is given by the Hirsch polynomial on this H1 tensor H1. But if I know this determinant, sorry, this Hirsch polynomial, then I can just reverse engineer and compute what's the action of Frobenius on this one. So so in the end, I'm just asking like counting the number of eigenvalues that are p. By the way, this is not how Tate did it. It did more work because I'm using Tate conjecture over and over. So by just factoring this Hirsch polynomial on H1 tensor H1, I can indeed compute the rank of my infinite algebra for any extension. On the other hand, I know when all the cycles are defined, I can stop. And also important for us is that Tate also showed that if you look at the field generated by Frobenius, that's indeed the center of your endomorphism algebra. So let's just boil this down to an example. And so to make something like concrete, we can look at it. So let me remind you, the only thing I'm really using is a theorem attributed to Tate, that the rank of my inference algebra is this dimension of this kernel. So what does this mean for a concrete example? I pick an abelian variety, which the Hirsch polynomial is given by 1 minus 2t squared plus 25t to the fourth. Now I do some linear algebra. I compute what's the action on H1 tensor H1. Now I get this lovely factorization. And now what we need to think about here is that we need to look at when 5 is an eigenvalue, how many times? So you can see it's 4 times because it corresponds to this factor. So over F5, my rank is going to be 4. And indeed, I know it's going to be the Frobenius polynomial, sorry, the field generated by Frobenius, which is going to be the field generated by this this polynomial, since it's irreducible. And that's just q squared minus 2, q squared, comma square root of 3. But now I can look back at the factorization and see that I already took care of this factor. If I go to 25, then this 5 is going to become minus. So this is a minus 5 eigenvalue, now becomes a 25. So that's where I attend all the other cycles, because this guy and this guy will not change, or sorry, it will not produce any eigenvalues, because basically these are not cyclotomic polynomials. So you can see that the middle coefficient is not divisible by 5. So the only thing I really need to look at is at these two guys. So indeed, all the morphisms are going to be defined over F25. And then I can just ask myself, what is the determinant of Frobenius squared? And I'm going to see that it's going to be a square of an elliptic curve with this polynomial. So basically, I just split where there was squares, just divide everything by, plus t squared by t. And now this field gives me q squared of minus 6. So in the end of the day, I have that my inference algebra is indeed the matrix algebra over q squared of minus 6. Okay, any questions so far? So this is just working out the Tate theorem for abelian varieties. Now, the idea is that we want to do something with it for elliptic curves. So we want to now combine two primes. So let me put this example in such context. So I take my abelian variety to be a Jacobian of this genus two curve. Again, that's a label of LMFDB. You can click on it and see what information we have about it. And so I already gave you the example about p equals 5. And the example for p equals 7 is identical, with a small difference that when you look what happens at over F7 bar, which basically you just look at over F49, now instead of getting q squared minus 6, you get q squared minus 10. Now, what can we conclude from this? If you go back to the table, the obvious thing you can conclude is that it cannot be, when I tensor with R, I can obtain M2C. Because for that to happen, this field will need to match. So we are making some progress, and the point is that show that indeed we can do this all the time, and we can even recover more information about that. Now, this might seem quite complicated to do all these manipulation with polynomials. Obviously, we can automate this. But we also try to look into the narrow and severe lattice, which plays a different role. So the narrow severity for abelian varieties, I should have written it here, is just the endomorphisms algebra, is that the endomorphisms fixed by Rosati involution. So basically, should think about it as a vector space. Is just a subspace of the endomorphism algebra. And for a abelian surface, the rank of narrow severity over Q bar can only take the values 1, 2, 3, 4. However, over FP bar can take 2, 4, 6. So in this example, if I try to go this approach, computing these ranks explicitly, again, it's all about Frobenius polynomials. I can compute that the rank is 4. And I can also compute the discriminant of the narrow severity at both primes over FP bar. And I can see that, again, very related to the same thing, is minus 6 and minus 10, the same number that showed up before. And what this tells me that you have these two lattices, and I know that inside of these lattices, there's the narrow severity over Q bar. So because the discriminants do not align model squares, then my rank of narrow severity over Q bar cannot be 4. Because if it was 4, they'll need to align. So must be at least, it can be at most 3. And by theorem of Charles, we know that this is always going to provide a tight upper bound.
So this is not effective, right? So there is a priori, we don't know where it is. So it's like Bjorn's theorem, actually. I think Bjorn was the first to come up with such a statement.
Bjorn's theorem.
Boonen. That there's an algorithm that's bound to time, but you don't have an a priori bound to the running time.
I think
it's the same thing here.
Without a question, I'll elaborate a bit more if you want to get something effective, because this gives you I'll tell you, it's going to give you a tight upper bound. I don't tell you what prime to look at. You don't know. Like, we don't know. It can be a million, can be, need to go a billion, trillion, we don't know. Obviously, in practice, it's very small, but we don't know. But let me just put now in perspective everything with this rank of narrow severity, which I have not elaborated very much about it, but now we can put them in the same table. And we can see that what we did, it's very similar. Like, we basically, in both examples, we just rule out the top line, that's it. But now we can see that the rank of narrow severity seems to be a bit poorer invariant, but in reality, for genus 2, we are able to distinguish between all these cases by looking at the Frobenius polynomial. So it's a poorer invariant for genus 2, but it gets more interesting for genus higher because it's a very simple invariant, just a number instead of like being an endomorphism algebra. So the question is, can we apply this kind of methods for generic abelian varieties?
Sorry, maybe you're going to tell us that, but so the first question I would have, well, how does this vary? I mean, in your thesis, you studied the variation of Picard ranks of Q3s, but how do these things, change as they go from prime to prime? Is there good statistics on that?
How do they change from prime to prime? Introduction, Yuri and I, we work on studying this variation. Let me just go back one slide. For K3 surface, studying like all these two numbers relate to them, I'm going to talk about that. But basically, they relate as you expect, in terms of they relate very similar to Lang-Trotter conjecture. It's not as you expect, but for many cases, for example, if you take a product of elliptic curves, then this basically boils down to Lang-Trotter conjecture, like asking like, when these numbers increase over FP bar, is basically related to the question like, how often the two elliptic curves become isogenous, for example. And so that's a very, 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 very kind of Lang-Trotter conjecture, Lang-Trotter question. And what you observe indeed is like Lang-Trotter behavior. So today I'm not gonna talk about how these two numbers relate, But it's a very interesting problem, which I've spent some time studying about, like, if you start with something, for example, with rank one, how often are you gonna observe like rank four or rank six?
Mm-hmm.
I talked about that at my Vantage talk a couple months ago. So you can go watch that, it's on YouTube also. But today I'm gonna talk about that. Today I'm just gonna focus on the idea of, I would like to be able to to, given a bit of variety, tell you where, in what box you're gonna fit in. So now I'm gonna kill you a bit with notation, but just hold on for a bit, just because I just wanna be precise about the theorem and then we'll do examples. So first thing, I need to go to the number field where every endomorphism is defined. So again, if you think about algebraic cycles, I'm just going to go to the field where all the algebraic cycles are defined, or the generators for algebraic cycles are defined. Then I can decompose my Abelian variety up to isogeny. So then I write AK as a product of powers of AI, sorry, products of powers of AI, where AI is simple and unique up to isogeny over K. Now, for each AI, I can define BI to be my endomorphism algebra of that AI. Is a central symbol algebra, and as a center, I'll call that Li. Now, the dimension of the algebra over the center is always a square, and I call that the square root of that number Ei. And all this is to basically write the endomorphism algebra of AK, which equals the endomorphism algebra of AK over Q bar, because I assume this, is just as this nice expression. So basically, I'm just going to the number field where I can write this uniquely. Not worry about it anymore. Now the theorem is that if Mumford-Tate conjecture holds for A, then we can compute the number of factors, and we can compute some combination of these EI and I, and NI dimension AI. So at the moment, I invite you to ignore that and compute the centers. So first point, we don't have a upper bound on the primes you need to look at. We don't have an effective version. So we show that, and we make them more precise, that there are two primes out there, that if you consider those two primes, you can compute everything. But a priori, we don't have a upper bound for those two primes. But regardless, this is practical. So if you try a couple of primes, you're gonna get something that makes you happy. And if you don't assume Mumford-Tate conjecture, then we won't get the upper bounds. We don't know the upper bounds will ever be tight. In reality, we never found a counterexample, so far we still believe Mumford-Tate conjecture holds. I want to say something else. Okay, maybe trying to answer Yuri's question about like, okay, this is not effective. We don't know when to stop. So how will we ever apply this in practice? The reality is for Abelian varieties, life is easier. So the idea, and I'm just going to say it out loud, because there's this paper with four authors that basically does both the sides, and this paper with Lombard and Voigt tackles the Li case. The idea is that we can use the fact that an Abelian variety is just a torus. It's just C to the G, over a lattice. Now, my endomorphism algebra is endomorphism of that lattice. So numerically, I can compute the endomorphism of the lattice, but that's only numerically. But now, the interesting part that we tackle in this paper is that given a numerical endomorphism, we can try to approximate it in some way that produce a divisor in A cross A. And by producing a divisor with algebraic equations, then you certified that was just not a numeric bug, but indeed that endomorphism exists. So it's like, so to really compute all these things with a proof, you need to run a by day and by night algorithm. By day, you search for numerical endomorphisms and try to prove that they are really endomorphisms. By night, you try to show that you're not missing anything. So in some way, what I'm giving you here, you should just take as upper bounds, which I'm saying that they're going to be tight at some point, but I cannot tell you when. Okay, so now I'd like to go to the proof idea in a simple case. But before I go, I want to know if there are any questions. I'll give more examples what all these things mean in a couple of slides.
Yeah, so emphasize, presumably it's all about counting points for finite fields and things like this, or computing the L function. But maybe there are other ways. So you said, okay, the J invariant with high precision. Yeah. I mean, you could try to guess what the periods are with high precision. And then, well, based on that.
So there are other ways that have been done already. So if you have two L functions associated to modular forms, say, and they have discriminant conductors, you just have if the APs agree up to the square root of the conductor, then you can prove effectively that the L functions are the same. If you assume the Riemann hypothesis, you only need to check that the APs are the same for primes up to log squared of the conductor.
Yes.
So these theorems are known. I mean, I proved one of these theorems with Hofstede a long time ago. It's for elliptic curves.
The key part here is that.
But you don't know that the L functions associated to these objects are modular. I mean, we don't know that.
Or even better, I give you an abelian variety. It's the question like, exactly, are they modular? And then if they are, for example, if they are GL2 type, then there's this, I don't remember the name now, but there's two papers that basically tackle the question, like just by looking at the APs, tell me on the nose what's the anamorphic algebra of this abelian variety associated with this model form. And for example, SP4, so now you go to genus 2, they are similar formulas, but I don't know anyone has written them now because it gets more complicated and more complicated. But the key part here is that we're doing this for what I call higher genus. I'm not relying on any classification. And that's the beauty of this. I'm teaching this to a computer. I can teach it to a computer, like compute L polynomials, do these intersections accordingly, and we'll spit out these numbers as upper bounds. And we know that if you give enough primes, you're going to get that's going to be an equality of assuming upper states. Because once we start to assume classification, less becomes much easier. For example, for genus 2, I could, for example, try to study what's the image of the Galois representation. And then I can use that to try to rule out certain cases. But that relies on me understanding what are the potential images. So that's why I'm trying to just, that's what I mean by Stone Age algorithm, that I'm not using any advanced classification for higher genus. I'm just trying to use Fermi's polynomials, which is very useful if you just want something that works for many cases.
I want to ask you a question. How is A given? Are you assuming that you're dealing with Jacobians?
The theorem is written in a way that we don't need that. We just need to be able to compute the Frobenius polynomials. This part of given this tight upper bound is just assuming that you're giving Frobenius polynomials. To compute, to do what you
do. No, I'm asking how A is given. How is your abelian variety given? Or are you thinking of a Jacobian?
For this theorem, the abelian variety is given as a black box that gives you Frobenius polynomials.
Oh, okay. No, I understand. But the other type of computation, you have to...
Jacobian. At the moment, I'm using Jacobian because I need to compute the periods. That's a key part. And we don't know how to compute periods. We know how to compute periods for hyperbolic curves, quartic curves, superelliptic curves, and then the life gets harder. Oh no, sorry. Now at the moment, I think the SAGE has implemented for more generic plane curves, but yeah, we only know to do it for curves. So we were relying on that.
Thank you.
But yeah, that's the key part about the other side of these algorithms, that at the end of the day, we need to use numerical pure maps to get the divisors, to get the proof. And that's how we did for LMFTB. So every curve in LMFTB, when you say that n over algebra is this thing, we have proven it. We have computed a tight upper bound and explicit divisors showing each endomorphism. Okay, but now let me try to give you the proof, which is the idea of the proof, which is very simple. So I'm going to isotypical setting. And the idea is that, in this case, I'm basically saying that I cannot compute the power. I don't know about the power, but I compute the n times e, where e squared is my dimension of my center simple algebra. And also can compute the center. And the main ingredient is this work of Z-Wiener, which is really, really good. And I really like that paper, that basically showed that for primes in a set of density one in K, where K is my number field where everything is defined, my Abelian variety over FP, where this P is like the residue field of that, frac P, is gonna be a power of another Abelian variety to the power e to the n, where C is geometrically simple. So basically, this is what allows us to compute e to the n. That's basically it, because we know for a set of positive density, set of density one in K, we have always this happening. So more primes you take, either you keep seeing the same thing, or you just see things that are higher than e n, because it cannot go lower. And then the idea to compute L is that, as you expect, furthermore, like if you give another prime that now depends on P, that's the hard part. There's also a set of density one that when you take the intersection of Frobenius fields, you're gonna get L on the nose. So in the end, it's like, we're just saying that if you look at primes out there, your Abelian variety in this isotypical case, modulo P should always factor as a power E times N. So if you think about an Abelian surface with quaternion multiplication, you always going to observe a square of elliptic curve. And that's basically what you're observing here. And now you ask what could be the Frobenius fields. And what you're saying is that they're all random fields with the right dimension would contain L. And any two of them, when you intersect them with probability one, you're gonna get L. And the hard part here is actually there's lack of effectivity because we have these two sets of density one that we cannot control, or we don't yet know how to control. So it cannot tell you when to stop looking. And recently, David Zwin has improved our method to compute the satellite group of AK. So basically the quantity component of your satellite group, if you started with an Abelian variety over a lower field. Okay, so now I'd like to show you some examples, or like one example to try to show you what does this mean for genus two. But it basically just means like I'm gonna try to put these tuples, what I had before, EI and I and I dimension AI, and look at the same table again. And now you can see that we kind of do a good job for this classification that I picked, by the way. And that's a key part that I'm the one picking the classification, is that so far it looks like we are able to distinguish, if you look at row by row, it's all different. And more interestingly, we distinguish all the six cases, but that's not really a classification that we like to look at, because in reality, I have this itemized list inside of some of these rows. And you really want to distinguish between these two, all these rows. And the case that's hard is this case I was talking about before, is that locally, an Abelian surface with quaternion multiplication is identical to a square of a elliptic curve without complex multiplication. And our algorithm also fails at that. If you compute all those invariants, you're gonna get exactly the same thing. Your center is gonna be Q. So basically locally, you're always gonna observe M to Q and nothing else. The local information will tell you that you have something looks like M to Q or a quaternion algebra over Q. But you cannot distinguish between the split case and non-split case. And in this case, we can do better. And this is again, now I'm going diverging from the fact that I don't know nothing about genus to curves, and I'm going to start to use things that I know about genus to curves. So that's the only case for genus two, is that in the example we were looking before, which I'm going to remind you that basically show that we are not on a top row. But if you compute those numbers, you're going to land on this row that is a bit unsatisfactory because there are these two completely distinct cases in terms of geometry, but locally they'd be very similar. So can we distinguish between B being split or not? So in other words, like B is a quaternion algebra, can be M to Q, so discriminant is one, or can be something else? And the answer is, in this case, we can. And this is a trick by John Voigt that observed that if you need L is ramified in B, then L cannot split in Frobenius, in the Frobenius field. So we can just, again, try primes one at a time and see which prime they can rule out that cannot be ramified in B. Oops, sorry. So in the case, like we, for example, by looking at Q squared of minus three, so this was, this was P equals three. We can rule out 5, 14, 17, and so on. At looking at P equals five, we can rule out 7 and 11. So seven, like all these primes cannot divide the discriminant of P. And you just keep going on forever and ever. And exactly in this case, you can just rule out all the primes except two and three. And obviously I cannot rule out all the primes because it's always up to some bound. Because I'm just doing this prime by a prime. I'm trying, if I want to rule out the prime L, I need to find a Frobenius P and try to rule it out. If that one doesn't work, I try another one. But in this case, there's no hope to do better because you need discriminant of B six. And it is this case is an abelian variety with quaternion multiplication. And again, to show that, what we did is not enough. We need to go to the abelian variety using it. Oh, sorry. In this case, I'll go to the curve. I look at C cross C, and I'm going to exhibit explicit divisor that represent this quaternion multiplication. But this is what I'm talking today. Today I'm just talking about upper bounds here. Okay, now I'm going to switch a bit of gears. I'm going to go away from abelian varieties. So it's a good time to more questions if you have, or if you want to expand something more. Okay, looks no questions. Okay, so far, if you look at what I've been doing, the global picture is that I have this abelian variety. I have these algebraic cycles defined over finite fields. And I combine information from two primes to say something about the algebraic cycles of A over characteristic zero. But why stick to abelian varieties? So the next simplest example is surface. Now, I'm going to keep it simple. I'm going to keep the only talk about surface, but if you want, can replace this by even hypersurface in a toric variety. But for simplicity, just think about surface or smooth hypersurface. Anyway, pick the example that you're more comfortable with. The theory applies without a quirk. So, for surface, when you think about algebraic cycles, what we're going to talk about is like Picard numbers. So I take F is going to be a polynomial. For simplicity, I'm going to assume that F has Z coefficients, I'll just see later on, just because I want to like to think about reductions. And I can think about the Picard group and about the Picard number. So in the Picard lattice or Picard group, it basically just describes the number of independent algebraic cycles up to your favorite equivalency. So by the way, to generalize to these two non-surface, we stick to algebraic equivalency. That's the thing that we want to use. So things are very easy if my surface of degree D, my D is small. So D equals one, there's nothing. There's a line, so that's it. There's like one class for all the lines. D equals two, it's a bit more interesting, but it's quite boring. It's especially over Q bar is P1 cross P1. So you get two lines. Over for d equals three, life gets more interesting. Now is the blow up of six points in P2. So you have one plus six, that is seven. So basically you have the one coming from P2, and then you get six exceptional divisors that those give you the remaining classes. So far the theory is quite boring. But now when you go to the world of K-free surface or higher degree surface, things get much more interesting. So for d equals four, that's a K-free surface. Now, every number between 1 and 20 can arise, and you know that they arise. And the same thing for d equals five. And in general, like what I'm doing here is nothing else but just saying that I'm using the fact that my Picard lattice is just intersection of H11 as my odd structure with H2, my single cohomology. And so what I'm setting here basically is just that in this case, that my Picard number is between 1 and H11, where H11 is the dimension of this piece. So the problem we would like to tackle, and I'm not going to tackle that today because we don't yet know how to do that, is to compute this Picard number. So now the key part here is that this in principle is solved if given the Tate conjecture. And there are several attempts how to do this. So where do I want to start? So let me start by the last. Larez and Certus, they use numerical methods to compute the period of the K-free surface. And with that, they can do this based on their accuracy of the numerical methods, what's the Picard number? But that's not a proof. So you can get strong evidence what's the Picard number, but they're not able to give you proof because we don't know how many digits of precision we need to compute those periods. But for the practical purpose, this is the best method out there so far. Then I put here Shioda because Shioda gave us for many examples how to compute this Picard number. For example, by using the automorphism group of the K-free surface or using like elliptic vibration and so on. And then there are these three sets of people to tackle the case of the generic case. So, okay, I'll keep going in the same order. So there's Hassett, Kirsch, and Schinkel. And the idea here is that they pass the problem to the Kugel-Sadaka variety. So they give an upper bound, they give an algorithm that's with the upper bound on time, but the issue here is that it's not practical, in the sense that when you pass the Kugel-Sadaka variety, you get an abelian variety of a really large dimension, and then you need to compute an homomorphism algebra of that abelian variety to compute, then pass that differential back to the K-free surface. But that doesn't avoid the fact that now you need to try to search for algebraic cycles in a very large dimensional variety. Poonen, Tess, and Van Looy proved also that you can compute the Picard number, and they use the fact that Etal cohomology is computable. And the issue here is that, yeah, there's nothing wrong with their theorem, but I have not yet known anyone that's implemented Etal cohomology on a computer. So it's computable, but we don't know yet how to officially make it into a computer in a practical manner. And then finally, there's Charles. The proof is a bit different, but again, it's very similar to what we were doing before with the abelian varieties. He knows how to provide very tight upper bounds, but at the end of the day, you still need to search for divisors and show them for you to get the proof that you got the right Picard number. Not only needs to search on X, it also needs to search on X cross X. So that makes life a bit more complicated. So over Q-bar, problem is very hard, but over finite fields, life is much easier. So over finite fields, I have the Tate conjecture again. Which again is the same exact statement as before, but now replace, instead of H1, tensor H1 of A, I have H2. And the Tate conjecture is known for D less equal to 4, so it's known for K-free surface and everything below, but for our methods to even work, we always need to submit conjecture. So I'm going to submit from now on. And the way, again, we compute the dimension of this kernel is by computing the Hassel zeta function. So in the case of hypersurface, or in this case of a surface, it takes a very simple shape. It's one over this polynomial, where chi of t is just the determinant of Frobenius, sorry, principal of Frobenius acting on H2. So if I want, I can do this chi by just naively computing the number of points of my surface for large enough extensions. Obviously, it is not practical as long as you start, if you pick, make p large enough, if you run into problems very fast. So for example, if you already think about a k-free surface, this chi has degree 22, which means you need about 11, at least. So in generic, you just need 11 extensions. But now pick your favorite prime, for example, 17 to the 11 in p-free. So now if you have a lot of your loops, so you know the time, your running time is gonna be about p to the 22 at least. Yeah, p to the 22 times some logs. So p large enough, you're out of hope. But if you can compute this chi, then we can compute the Picard number, because again, as before, we just need to factor chi, or on the end, we just count the number of roots of certain shape. So in this case, I write the formula a bit differently and say that my Picard number is the number of roots. There's reciprocal roots of z such that z to the n equals p to the n. And obviously, as I said before, we cannot count, we cannot compute chi just by counting points. We need to use better methods. But even before mentioning that, we should note that because I'm counting the number of roots, and these roots come in pairs because these z's are going to be complex, then this implies that modulo 2, my Picard number of FP bar, is always going to be congruent to the second Betti number. So for k-free surface, it means always even. For abelian surface, for example, it's also always even. But for quintic surface, it's always odd. And I was saying before, p bigger than 7, forget about trying to do this by 9-point counting. And there's a wide infrastructure of methods in Christian cohomology to autocomplete this chi effectively. Indeed, that's what we're going to use in the background, but I'm not going to talk about that today. That's also a lot of my work there. So now let's try to use this idea to now help us to compute the Picard number. So as before I said n-dimensional algebras, now it's Picard lattice. So we have exactly the same thing. We have that Picard lattice of Q bar embeds the Picard lattice of FP bar. So our goal today for the second part of the talk is to improve this upper bound. Now notice, by parity reasons, this might fail completely already. You might have no hope of proving these bounds to be sharp. For example, if the Picard number is, if you're a k-free surface, this is odd, it's always gonna be even. There's no way you can ever attain a tight upper bound. And in sometimes, anomorphisms of the tensor lattice make our life much harder. I'm not gonna talk about that today, but just something that you should be aware that sometimes there are theoretical reasons why, even when both things are, for example, even for k-free surface, there's reasons why you can never get a tight upper bound. So there's a method by Van Looy, which first came with this idea of using two primes, and it's very similar to what we were doing before. That, and we did, we already did this for abelian surface, that you consider two primes. Here I'm assuming the k-free surface because I wrote 2R. Now it can be discriminant. If you can show that discriminants are not equal, then you automatically have that now the Picard number is less than your original upper bound. And indeed, Van Locke used this to show the first example over Q of a k-free surface with rank one, sorry, geometric rank one, which we knew that anything you took at random should have rank one. But we, before this idea of Van Locke, we did not know how to generate such surface, like with explicit equation. We knew they existed, but we did not know how to generate them. Again, under the right conditions, we know that there's no hope for this to succeed. So I'm going to say more about that, but just something to be aware. There's a second method also. This one is by Elsanian and Yano. So they showed something more. They showed that this embedding is a torsion-free co-kernel. What this means that if you have a if something, if an algebraic cycle is not obstructed to leaf, then some multiple of it is going to leaf. Or on the other hand, like basically every invertible shift leaves. That's the way you should think about it. If the ranks are equal, then every invertible shift leaves. So using this idea, they design an algorithm that does that to verify this. And here's the sketch. So the first thing is that you compute the lattice, not the dimension, the lattice on the nose over FT bar. Then you try to estimate the degree of the hypothetical divisors of the leaf. And then you use Gromner basis to verify that such divisor either exists or does not exist. Now, main difficulty. First, computing the lattice of FP bar. That's not trivial. If the lattice is large dimension, that can be very hard. Second, we need math. It's very hard to make this a computer to do this. We need to have estimates depending what you find on this lattice to then estimate what the degree of the hypothetical lifts. And for last, you are using Gromner basis. You can one and two can run fine, and then you can start Gromner basis and then just wait forever for it to finish. So they show how to do this in some examples, but life can get in your way very fast. So our approach with Amherst Certus is a bit different. So let me just say the problem again. I give an F and P on improving inequalities. Notice that in this inequality, I can put QP bar here. And the idea is try to lift algebraic cycles, in this case curves, from FP bar to QP bar, thickening by thickening. So I notice I'm running out of time. So I'm gonna just put the whole slide in one go. So first thing is that the cohomology in QP bar was or FP bar was quite fine. So we also have this over Q, you have this Hodge filtration. And similarly, if you put coefficient over QP, in this case, I note that for KP surface, that filtration dimension is 22, 21, in 1. And over characteristic P, we have similar statement. But now we cannot write that Picard is intersecting for H11 because H11 doesn't make sense anymore. But we have this lovely theorem of Berthelot and August and Renault that tells us that Picard once again can be given as an intersection of over FP bar and the first filtration. So basically this means that if something does not in F2, then it should be liftable. And that's what you're gonna do. So are we gonna do that? We really want like to compute this intersection. And once again, we're gonna use state conjecture. State is the main axis today. And the idea is that the state conjecture starts afterwards in a p-adic setting. Now is a QP vector space. Also again, I have that my Picard lattice, my Picard vector space, then in this case, is going to also again be given by this kernel. So the idea is that I compute this approximation, p-adic approximation. Then I compute my obstruction map, so H2 comma F1, quotient F1. And then by computing the kernel p-adically, I can compute an upper bound on my Picard number. Now, one should be very careful with doing p-adic linear algebra, because if you don't do it carefully, you're going to get wrong results. But the claim is that, yeah, we can all do this it's possible to do this correctly and carefully and get very nice upper bounds, much better than before. And usually we pick a really nice basis that already respects logical progression. And then this map indeed is just coordinate projections. So there's nothing to do. So in my last minute, I was going to give you one example, which is an Abelian surface. And I know that Abelian surface is not exactly what I was talking about, but is the only example I can really put on a slide. Anything else is just going to overflow of numbers and never ends. So I start a new Abelian surface. I can compute this Frobenius action. In this case, mod PQ is this matrix. I have my Chris polynomial. Now I can just linear algebra compute what happens at H2 because H2 is H1 wedge edge wedge one. I get discrete polynomial, which means that over FP bar, I have two cycles. Indeed, they are defined over FP. And now I just need to compute my obstruction map. So I compute first the two eigenvectors. So those will be the generators of as a QP vector space on a Picard lattice. And I can see that one of them, the last coordinate, which is really the obstruction map, is not zero mod p squared. So it means that I know that the algebraics I considered this vector cannot lift. And therefore, we improve our upper bound from 2 to 1. And in this case, implies that anomalous in algebra is, something happened here. In this case, anomalous in algebra is Z. Obviously, in this example, Van Loock's method lab succeeded. And the key part is that we have automated this and have some more examples on the slides. And in this case, if I ran this example, just we have this in a stage map package and you can just run it and get what you desire. And anyway, I don't want to go over time. I'm happy to talk more, but I want to give opportunity for people to leave if they want. No pressure. So I'm going to stop here.
Great. Thanks so much. Are there any questions? Well, no questions.
So can you say something about higher co-dimension cycles on abelian varieties?
So life gets harder there because now we have a really issue about what equivalence relation you're going to pick. For like divisors, algebraic, numerically, are all is the same. But when you start to talk about other codimensions, then life gets harder. So we can only talk about algebraic equivalency. And as long as you can compute the Frobenius action, I don't see an issue why the method cannot be applied. We wrote a paper for projective hypersurface, but the reality is we just show with the abelian surface is as long as you have a Frobenius action, and you know how it acts. On a basis that respect the odd structure, life is easy. You can apply the method because the Barefoot theorem is quite generic. That's not only depends for Picard, but it's like it works for the Miller Picard number. That's what we wrote the paper about.
But in practice, are there easy examples can be computed?
No, because it's like the case that the main problem is like outcompute the Frobenius action, and so far, I only know methods that can compute like in hypersurface, because most of these methods are using some kind of chaotic cohomology that works very nice for a fine and smooth varieties. So in some way you really want hypersurface. So when you take the complement, you get something affine. So it's I don't know any example where people have computed Frobenius action in other settings.
I see. Thank you.
Any other questions? Well, if not, I'm going to stop the recording and let's thank our speaker one more time.